Our next speaker worked with Ryanair, Ulla Popken, and Bijenkorf, and helped some of those companies optimize their conversion rates. We met a couple of years ago at Conversion Hotel at Texel for the first time and spoke briefly there, so I'm really glad to see him here again and continue that conversation. Now on the stage, a fellow Lego builder, please give a big hand for Rutger de Groot.
Hi. Dankjewel. Cool. Right. Hi, everybody. So let's begin. Right. That's the wrong button. Cool. So yeah, this happened 3 months ago. I completely lost my shit. Now, most of people who know me say he's actually a normal guy, not that special, and he's really calm, and if something happens, it's okay. But 3 months ago, I really, really lost it. And it was because of a number. Funny, right? How a number can suddenly change everything. So before I lose it again, I'll quickly introduce myself. I've been testing for the past couple of 10 years, and for the last 3 years with my own company, Mint Minds. And we help companies on training, on consulting, on running experiments, basically helping them to make sure that they reach their optimization goals. And so this was the number that completely freaked me out. 47.2%. And why this number? Because 47.2%, according to the industry report done by CXL, which had about 700 people filling in on the server, 47.2% of them said that they have no process for stopping their tests. And it completely blew my mind. I mean, how the hell in 2018 or 19 now is it possible that you don't have a process for stopping your A/B test? Because if you don't have this process in place, there is a big risk that the quality of your data becomes meaningless. Because there's a good chance that you are stopping your tests too early at the first signs of a negative signal. And that you haven't defined a proper runtime for your A/B test, right? So you probably don't know about the correct sample size for your A/B test. And you probably haven't taken into account external factors that might impact the data of your A/B test, like sales campaigns or site deployments. And there's a good chance that you just keep the test running until you have sufficient data, with the risk that you run your test longer than 30 days, which can impact the quality of the data because of the cookie runtimes. So the number freaked me out for a reason, because it shows that there is a big knowledge gap between statistics and data quality. And then it also shows in the report that the number one problem that CROs face today is establishing a well-defined testing process. And this correlates with the number that I showed you earlier, because if you cannot recognize the mistakes that you are making in your own test setups, then it becomes really hard to create a good testing process. And in that same survey, 18% of so-called CRO agencies said that they don't even use or have a testing process. I mean, how the hell is this possible? What are you doing? Are you just thinking of an A/B test when you're on the toilet? And then just wait for the tool to suddenly have the color turn green and the tool says, yay, the test is successful? Is this really still going on right now? So why? Why is this still happening? I mean, there's been so much written already, and every event that I go to, at least there's one guy or girl speaking about a proper testing process. So there is tons of information out there for you to learn about. And a testing process isn't rocket science. You have these basic steps like analysis, hypothesis, then you go into design, build the thing, the test runs, you do analysis again, you get some learnings, and then you share it and you do it all over again. This is nothing new. So why are you still not doing this? I mean, you have to have a process, a recurring process for A/B testing, because the consistency of running through a process improves the quality of the work that you are doing. And this improved quality will lead to the point that you learn more from every test that you run, opposed to when you don't have a good process in place. And luckily, in this day and age, there are a lot of tools already that can help you set up a good process for you to follow, that you can work together if you have colleagues in different departments. And they're not that expensive, but at least go out there, get a tool, think about how the steps work for you and how you go about it. I mean, this guy said it, famous, well-known statistician, if you can't describe what you're doing as a process, you don't know what you're doing. Right? It's still true. So remember your testing ABCs. I quickly go through them because you probably have seen them before. Always be critical about your test setup. So that means, is your ID based on data? And if yes, was that data measured correctly? Is the data set large enough for an A/B test? Because if it isn't large enough, then it makes no sense to even run the test, because the outcome is statistically not valid. People still making lots of mistakes with their hypothesis. Is my hypothesis formed correctly? Does it contain where? Which page are we testing, or which device? And what is the effect that we're trying to achieve? And are we using the right metrics to define or even detect success or not? And do my designs match with the hypothesis? Sometimes you see people, they go in, they have a hypothesis, and they start thinking about the designs for the A/B test. And then all of a sudden a colleague comes in, and he or she says, wouldn't it be great if we just move this part over there in a different color and then add this little text? And before you know it, the whole test concept deviates completely from the hypothesis, right? So when you start following that path, the outcome has nothing to do with the hypothesis that you formed earlier. And do my designs work with all page variables, especially when you're testing in e-com and testing on complicated pages like lister pages, product pages, or shopping cart pages? There are a lot of variables that you have to deal with. And do your designs work in all the required browsers that you've, as a company, decided to support? And are you tracking everything that you want to track, and is it working correctly? Then, did we account for all external factors that can impact our data? Like site deployments. Everybody that's running a big site, they work in sprints, so probably every week there will be a deployment. And sometimes it can break the code of your current test. Do you account for that in your process? Do you have marketing campaigns? All of a sudden, an email marketing is sent out with a 10% discount. That will impact behavior from visitors, so it will impact your A/B tests. Do you account for that? And have you calculated the runtime of your A/B test? And if you're doing a lot of A/B testing, is your A/B testing, are your tests overlapping with each other? Right? Because you're trying to impact the behavior in test A, but how is that impacted behavior in test A, what's the effect when they end up in test B? Or are you separating the test population between your tests, right? So these are really, really the basics when you're thinking about your tests and your test setup. And I know this can sound overwhelming and complicated, but actually it's not. Because when you've thought about a process, you have defined guidelines and rules for every step in the process. And it just makes it a lot more easier. It's like going through a long, long checklist. So I had this discussion the other day with Roy. He's a colleague of mine. And we talked about it. How is it possible today that companies are still struggling with this, right? And the reason why we agreed on why companies are still struggling is because conversion rate optimization and data-driven experimentation requires a lot of diverse skills, right? You have web analytics, you need somebody for UX research, then statistics is a really important part. Psychology is coming more into play these days. Then, of course, development and design. So the companies I go to, the smaller companies, they have the problem that CRO is a part-time job for one or two persons, right? So they're responsible for different other tasks. So their knowledge level on all these topics might not be sufficient enough, and that's why they it's one of the reasons that they keep making these mistakes. And larger companies, on the other hand, that are already testing, they have the same problems but on a different level, because they have product owners and they are responsible for a specific part of the website. And all these activities are spread out across different departments. And having those departments line up and work in unison can be a big challenge for these companies. So today, the title said what we've learned and earned from our customers last year. I want to go beyond the basics that I just showed you. And some are strategies, and some are technical solutions for problems that you might face. And this one is pretty old, right? My fault is not your fault. And I understand that some of you might be thinking, Rutger, really? The fault? Are we still talking about this today? Yes. Yes, we are. And the reason is that we see a lot more different devices today than we saw 10 years ago. You have smartphones and tablets and all sorts of devices. And on each of these devices, the fault is different. And unfortunately, when we're working, we get tunnel vision sometimes, and we're just forgetting about all these different experiences. And so we forget about the fault. So here's a case from the Bijenkorf, where the fault actually had a big impact. So I'll show you what I mean. So this is the product page from the Bijenkorf. And when we started with them, we went through their customer feedback. And they had gathered lots and lots of customer feedback on the previous months before we started. And the number one problem that visitors had was that the availability was an issue. So when they have a sale campaign or whatever, the right size is not there, the right color. Availability is a big issue. So when we took that information and we started looking at the product page, we saw that this green line was the fault for almost 23% of the visitors. Let me go back. But this part here that tells the visitor that you can sign up for an email notification when the product gets back on stock again, Right? So if you're on the page and you want the product but it's not on stock, you can sign up for an alert email through this feature right here. And then once the product gets back on stock, you get an alert. So really important feature, basically, and it's solving an important problem for a lot of visitors. And the email campaign, I unfortunately cannot disclose the number of the amount of emails that they send out every month, but it was a really significant number. So we've made an A/B test based on that information. And what we did here, we've changed the add to cart button because normally it's just deactivated. And we made the new function of the add to cart button the sign up for the email alert. So we basically took the feature and put it above the fold and also tell people that the product is temporarily not available. So the results were pretty cool. We've increased the clicks on the back on stock alert with over 50%. And the actual increase on people who did sign up, because when you click on the button, you get a short sign up form. The actual people that did sign up increased with 42%. So this is a clear case where you can see that the fold is still relevant in this day and age. And when you are optimizing your website, it's a really important strategy to find out which key features on your website, if they are still above the fold across different devices. This is another case for Ulla Popken. Ulla Popken is a plus-size fashion brand. They're really big in Germany. They also have retail stores here in the Netherlands. And this shows it a bit better. So we actually did an A/B test on the product page. And here you can see the average fold for most visitors. Now you will directly notice that the product thumbnails for most visitors are below the fold. And this is very, very important information because you want visitors to engage with your product. And if you don't give them a reason to engage with it, they simply will not do it, right? And product thumbnails are a key feature to get people engaged. So what we did, we moved the thumbnails to the left side to make sure that it would be above the fold. And when we ran the test, we integrated Hotjar heat maps with them. We do that standard on basically every A/B test, because you can't measure anything, or you can't measure everything in Google Analytics. So that's why we love heat maps. And here you can clearly see the difference, right? Engagement went through the roof on the thumbnails once people actually see them. We've measured it obviously also through analytics, and the engagement on clicks went up with 42%. Add to wish list went up. Add to cart went up. Funny was that for return visitors, there was no effect on orders because they were probably already familiar with the site and knew that the thumbnails would be below the fold. But for new visitors who were not familiar with Ulla Popken, there was an increase on orders. Right, so I've shown you an example on how the fold is still relevant or vital for your company and your business. But I've been talking to a lot of CROs. I'm in Conversion World's Slack group and on Facebook and some conversion groups. And a question that kept popping up over the year was that CROs have difficulties to measure their test when they're testing below the fold, right? They have questioned that, how do I define if people see my tests, or should I just look at visitors when the page load directly? And the first thing I want you to learn is how your tools work in the smallest detail, right? Because If you don't know how your tool works, you don't know its limitation, and you don't know you won't find a way to overcome that. So basically, on testing tools, what they do when they count the visitor, the script loads, the test loads, and boom, they count the visitor. It's the same with Google Analytics. The page loads, and they count it as a visitor. But that doesn't mean that the visitors have actually seen the changes that you've made to the test, right? So you need to know that they saw the change before you can say that they are a good visitor. So here's the case with Lamp & Licht. And this is funny, because they're a really cool company. They sell lamps, obviously. But they've just went through a redesign process, and they went through a migration from Magento 1 to Magento 2. And they were completely fed up with redesigning. So they now only want to do A/B testing, which is cool. But they obviously had the problem of designing for multiple devices. And what they did was, like most companies are doing, they went for a responsive design. And on first glance, a responsive design is cool, right? It solves a lot of issues for developers, and you're sure that the site works good in most situations. But in this instance, the smartphone website becomes really long. It probably ends somewhere here, right? And they just shuffle and compress all the information, not knowing where which part is going, and also not knowing if the relevant information is in the right order. So we've ran a couple of heat maps on smartphone devices on their content, and this part right here is just below the top of the fold, right? So you just scroll down, then you get this, then you get this, then you get this. And the content that you see here are the basic company USPs, and then there is advice on shopping or assistance for shopping. And this part right here, this is actual product content, like product description, technical specifications. And so you can clearly see that nobody is interested in this part, right? It's dead obvious. People are interested in actual product information, right? But only 30.9% of the visitors actually get to that part of the page. So knowing that, from the heat map, we've rearranged the information in the right order for the interest of the visitor. So this part and this part went way down, and the actual product content, because of it, went up. Back to the problem of measuring below the fold, because this was all below the fold, right? So how do we measure people actually seeing the changes? We created an event based on a viewport. So when a part of the website comes in the viewport of the browser, of the visitor, we will fire an event, hey, they have seen this part of the website. So we now know that they actually seen the changes. And based on that, we make a segment in Google Analytics, and based on that segment, we can then better analyze our test results, because we know that the visitor had actually seen the changes. And this piece of code really does it all. This is a free gift to you. You just enter your selector here, and it will work. So yeah, we'll share the presentation afterwards, of course. But this is really cool. So what happened in terms of results? This part here got an uplift on 20% in clicks, and this part here got an uplift in 4.2 in clicks. Actually, the add to cart rate went down. That's strange, right? Because you would expect it to go up. But the orders went up, right? Because people just go more browsing. They learn about the product. Is it a good fit? Is it not a good fit? They're actually deciding on the product page already if they want it. Once they are committed, they're more likely to continue. Yeah, heat maps. I know, right? Pretty cool if you can integrate them with your A/B test. So we use Hotjar for that. Probably everybody is using Hotjar. And you can trigger a heat map based on a JavaScript, with a JavaScript trigger. And this is the trigger that we use for that. My additional advice on that, fire the trigger on window load, because that means that all the content on the page is there and it's loaded. Otherwise, you might trigger it too early and some parts of the pages are not there and you get like half a page heat map. So it's information-wise, it becomes a lot less useful. So this is the trigger, fire it on window load. Then, master your Niagara Falls, right? That sounds a lot like Mr. Miyagi with the wax on and the wax off. But everybody knows when you're building sites or loading websites what I mean with waterfalls, right? This is how your page loads. I took this one from Yoast, as you can see, is fitting to the event. But when we are doing a A/B test, this is a major, major problem for a lot of CROs, and I'll tell you why. Because the test tool starts right in the top of the page in the header, right? And so it will check really fast, am I on the right page? Am I on the right device? Am I on the right audience? And then when all these condition checks are done, it will fire the script. So it will start doing the changes. But in some cases, your page is still loading, or the content that you want to change is still loading. It's not available. The script or the testing tool, in most cases, will ignore it. And it would just simply rush through it and continue. The end result of this is that there are no changes made whatsoever, right? So the tool will say you, and analytics will say to you, your test run, all is fine. But in reality, it actually didn't. Then there is another problem, especially on your, when you're on e-com retail websites, that you can do stuff on a page, the page changes, but without a page load, right? So if I'm on a fashion website and I change the size of the product or the color, it will just automatically load the new information without an entire page load. But the test script has already run. And it will run one time. So it won't detect all the changes that you're making. Luckily, testing tools have found solutions, but they're completely shit. It's fake news, people. Fake news. Because what they say to you is, we use a polling technique. Yeah. Every 50 milliseconds, we'll check if the content is there. Oh! Yes, we have conditional activation. When this part of the site is there, boom, we're changing it. No page flashing guaranteed. Uh-huh. And actually, for some tools, it's a good solution. But you're paying a premium, right? And we're Dutch. We're cheap. We like free. So, we have a solution. And I want to illustrate it with a case from the Bijenkorf. This was funny, actually, because they invited us to do some A/B tests on their website. Ooh, I have to rush. And this was actually the most complicated test that we had to do. They wanted to test the label, right? The discount labels. So they wanted to test if percentages would work better against euros. And they have a lot of variables on the website. So you would change the color, the size, and the price could actually change. They have suggested retail prices when they do show the discount label, and then they have brand agreements where they cannot show any labels. So there are a lot of different variables that would decide if a discount label was shown. And also, there was no guarantee if you would, when you go to the product the first time, if you would immediately saw a size or a color that would have a discount. So there were all kinds of different variables messing with our A-B test. This is the thing you want to use from now on. And it's free. It's a web API, the Mutation Observer. Who has heard about the Mutation Observer? Hands, please. Cool. It's still new information. basically, what it does, when your test script runs for the first time, it will create a listener. It's just a listener, and it listens for DOM changes. When it detects a change in the DOM, then the script is fired and makes all the changes, yes or no. So this is really a small and tiny, elegant way of building your A-B test. And if you're building tests, then I really recommend you to do it this way. So we had two variations, one with euros and one with percentages, and we added the wording discount because they don't show a currency symbol. So if we would have only just the euros, then there would be no context. So we added the word save X amount on the product. When we had the results, both variations actually did very well. Increase on add to cart and increase on orders. And the funny thing that we learned from this text, it wasn't actually the percentage or the euro discount, but it was actually the word bespar, which caused the uplift. So accidents still happen. So then, say no to bugs, just say no, right? QA can be very, very daunting. Like I showed you, we have a lot of different devices. We have even more browsers across these devices. But still, we want to make sure that our A-B test is completely flawless. Because if it's not flawless, we know that it will impact our data. And we want good data quality. And then there are these variables on the pages themselves. A cool case from the Bijenkorf, where we found a new way of doing QA on our A-B test. This is the smartphone page for the product. You can add a product in the cart, and then you get this screen, right? So imagine that you buy a bag for 10,000 euros on your smartphone. They do have bags of 10,000 euros. And this is the screen you get, right? That's not really comforting or reassuring. So we created a new design for that actually showed that which product was added to the cart for what price, and a little motivation here saying that products that are in your shopping cart are not yet reserved for you. And also we repeat the amount of that are still in stock. So we actually motivate visitors to continue. But as you can see, we have a lot of variables on this page, right? Because they have fashion products and non-fashion products, and they both have different product templates. We have regular prices versus discount prices, product title length, a lot of variables that we need to QA on. So what we did is we integrated a tool called Bugsnag, Who knows Bugsnag? Cool. It's a free tool. So you can just really simply integrate it in your A-B test. And what we did is that we start the test on a small percentage of visitors and then see which errors pop up. And then we can retrace the user steps leading to that error, and then we can fix it. And then once the test is stable and we don't see major errors popping up, we'll restart it again and or increase the population. And we're pretty sure that the test is good. So for this test, we also had cool results. So there was no effect on continue to shopping, but on orders, there was more than 5% increase. Then the last strategy that I want to talk about is respecting different user behavior. And it's still important because when we have all these different devices, we use them differently and with a different mental state. We make decisions differently. Our smartphone, one of the most popular devices, we use them everywhere in dubious situations and dubious locations. So our behavior is radically different than when we're on desktop devices, for example. So here's another case from Ula Popke. And we before we did this test, we actually did a survey on visitors and we asked them, when they visit the smartphone website, where do they actually use it? And we already noticed that it's all over. And then we asked them why, what is the goal or the purpose of the visit? And a lot of visitors said they were just browsing and saving the product for later. And still a big part, although the checkout was really crap at the time, said they want to order the product. Then when we looked further in analytics, we noticed that the time on site per visit for desktop is a lot longer than it is on smartphone. And the visits needed for a transaction is a lot bigger on smartphone than it is on desktop. So when we looked at the Lister page on smartphone and desktop, we noticed that they have really a huge assortment, right? And on smartphone, browsing through hundreds of Lister pages can be a tedious job, right? It's not easy browsing. It is a lot easier on desktop because the Lister pages just load faster. Your device, the desktop, has a lot more performance. So on mobile, this can be very challenging. On Conversion Hotel, we had Stephen Anderson, and he introduced the sandbox principle. And I thought that was really nice, right? Sometimes you have a goal, sometimes you don't. There is no clear path. And sandboxes enhance playful behavior and creativity. So we took that and we applied that to our Lister page. And we made it more easier for visitors to jump 10 pages or 12 pages or 3 pages because we've added a pull-down menu. So you can immediately go to page 10 or immediately go to page 12. So this improves the sense of autonomy for visitors, right? They have a better control of their situation because they have the right tools to decide how they want to. And they in the heat maps, you can see that they use the pull-down menu. And the results were amazing. So listing pages that were seen went up with 22%. Product page visits also went up with 22%. And orders went up with 34%. Now, when I see that number, there must be something wrong, right? That's too good to be true. Yeah. So we actually checked all the tracking and we just completely redid the test and we got exactly the same results. So final thing, statistics. Boring, but we can all agree, I think, that they are vital. And the tools, they have you covered. because you can do very advanced statistics in these tools. But the problem is you have to do it on their data, on third-party data. And you want to do it on your own data, right? And you can export data to Google Analytics, but Google Analytics won't provide you with the statistical calculators that you need to do these calculations. And there are a lot of free calculators online, but they all have limitations, a lot of limitations. So the amount of variations that you can calculate, the type of metrics that you can calculate, mostly they, you can only do binomial metrics like conversion rates, and you can't do revenue per user. So we went to work, and I have an exclusive for you. Yeah, we do. We've built our own Bayesian API. It took a while, but we got it done. So basically what you do, you build your standard reports from Google Analytics, and you dump it into our tool. Then you map the data and decide which metrics and data that you need and what type of metrics they are. And then you just calculate or let the API do the calculations for you. Who would want to use this? Nah, come on. So, features. You can do binomial, non-binomial metrics. You can do bulk data uploads. There's no limit to the amount of variations. You can automatically process multiple dimensions and all sorts of metrics. So why do we need this? Why are we doing this? Well, like you saw in the Conversion Excel report, right? There's still a lot to learn. People, there's still a knowledge gap. And we need statistical tools that are platform independent, no matter if you're doing Google Analytics or Adobe Analytics or some sort of exotic German analytics. And we want to give back to the community because it's important. And as a community, we need to optimize ourselves. So that's why we've decided that you can get free beta access to the tool if you're interested. So you can play around with it, give us feedback, because it's not done yet, obviously. We want to build a lot of cool new features that would help everybody. So if you like it and are interested, please send me a DM on Twitter or send me an email on the address. Almost good in time. Takeaways. Strategies for optimizations that I've discussed today. My fault is not your fault. Optimize your key features for the fault across different devices. Respect the difference in behavior for different devices. And techniques that can help improve the quality of your A/B test is event tracking based on viewports when you're testing below the fault. And improve the quality of your QA with a tool like Bugsnag. They have a free subscription, right? It doesn't cost you any money. And use the Mutation Observer web API so that you're absolutely sure that your test is running like it should. So there's still time for one more thing, and I know you hate it. There's a lot of more things. So everybody, take out your telephone. Open up your camera, please. Please. And then open the camera and please take a picture of this slide and post it on your favorite WhatsApp channel or Instagram. Because this guy is hosting free podcast and he is sharing knowledge about CROs and he has cool guests. So it's definitely worth watching. So it would mean a lot to me if you would support him. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So really quick, we were discussing before the talk, is there any time for Q&A? Well, there isn't, but we have 2 days of JoostCon. Rutger's going to be here 2 days. So please hook up with him in the foyer or whatever over coffee, and we'll see you there.